I brought along my son Jonathan, who in the year 2001 will be the same age as I am now. Maybe he will be better adjusted to this kind of world that you're trying to portray.
The big difference when he grows up, in fact, if we wanted to wait for the year 2001, is that he will have in his own house, not a computer as big as this, but at least a console through which he can talk to his friendly local computer and get all the information he needs for his everyday life, like his bank statements, his theater reservations, all the information you need in the course of living in a complex modern society. This will be in a compact form in his own house. He'll have a television screen like these here and a keyboard, and he'll talk to the computer, get information from it, and he'll take it as much for granted as we take the telephone.
The United States military had decided that they were going to leave aside a few dollars from the trillions they were spending on nuclear weapons to create a new form of mass communication. In the 1960s, the Advanced Research Projects Agency Network, or ARPANET, was created. This network was created to allow many researchers to access the few computers that existed in the continental United States, even where geographical barriers existed. The network began with four nodes, three in California and one in Utah. One evening in 1969, the first test of the network occurred between two of the California locations. At the University of California, Los Angeles campus, student Charlie Klein put finger to keyboard and began to communicate. His first goal was to log in, so he typed an L, then an O, and then the system crashed. They continued developing this system, making breakthroughs in communication technology that formed the basis of communication in the future. In 1971, the first email was sent over ARPANET, in which engineer Ray Tomlinson sent himself the top row of letters on the QWERTY keyboard. In 1973, researchers at MIT transmitted audio to and received audio from a team in California in the first conversation using digital audio. These efforts led to the establishment of the TCP/IP standard, which, to put it simply, allows computers on a network to determine which computer is which, as well as identify where network traffic is coming from. As time went on, this network expanded to include more and more universities, expanding outside of the United States to Europe and later Australia. The people who worked and studied at these universities wanted to be able to communicate with each other in a uniform way, and in the 1980s, Usenet was brought into existence.
In a 32-bit world, you're a 2-bit user. You got your own news group, all total losers.
Usenet was the first recognizable predecessor to the internet. While ARPANET was strictly for work purposes, to the point of it being a criminal offense in the US to misuse it, Usenet largely operated using telephone lines that did sometimes use the ARPANET network. Owners of servers on the network created newsgroups, originally created for the sharing of news. These newsgroups bear a resemblance to the structure of the modern internet forum, though the internet forum has fallen out of favor in recent years. Newsgroups were created for a wide variety of topics, including news, science, TV shows, movies, and religion, to name but a few. A user could find a particular newsgroup using the newsgroup's name, the style of which influenced the domain name system of the modern internet. For example, if a user wanted to learn about or discuss Adobe's Photoshop program, they would connect to comp.graphics.apps.photoshop. As time went on, more and more people began to connect to Usenet, including people from outside academia. The idea of netiquette, or how a user should conduct themselves online, had been established for some time, and included rules such as not typing in all caps, spamming, or general impoliteness. In September 1993, the eternal September, internet service providers began offering a wider array of people access to the internet. Previously, there had been a regular pattern of first-year university students gaining access to Usenet and not knowing any of the netiquette rules, annoying many experienced users. In 1993, however, Usenet was beginning to be open to a far larger audience. These new users were as troublesome, if not more, than the first-year students of years past. And as more and more of these Usenet beginners, or noobs, continued to pile in, it seemed to experienced users as if the September of 1993 never ended. Hence, the eternal September. From Usenet, many popular acronyms and phrases that remain in use today were brought into existence, such as ROFL, LOL, the idea of flaming, mean to argue impolitely and unproductively, as well as emoticons, the predecessor of today's emoji. The usage of Usenet and newsgroups declined in favour of new technologies and websites which used the Web 2.0 design technology, as most websites do today. There are still thousands of posts to newsgroups daily, though the quality and adherence to netiquette rules pales in comparison to the heyday of Usenet. You can see this for yourself, as Google Groups has an archive of many old newsgroups and conversations that are decades old. As a medium, newsgroups had allowed for communication similar to a conversation by mail, but the technology was capable of near-instant communication, and some chose to travel down this path.
Internet relay chat. It's how hackers talk when they don't want to be overheard.
The first internet relay chat program, named IRCD, was created by Finnish university staff member Jaakko Oikarinen in 1988. This spread across universities in Finland and then to the rest of Europe and the United States. The idea of an IRC is similar to group chats in instant messaging apps of today, where a text-based conversation with many people can occur with instantaneous responses, rather than checking in irregularly, as with newsgroups and sending mail. A conflict soon arose after the release of IRC due to stability issues. To put it simply, people would create servers on the network with the intention of wreaking havoc upon other servers, as a result of the interconnectedness of the IRC network at that time. This interconnectedness meant that, when a connection was severed between two servers on the network, the entire network was split into two networks, this event being known as a net split. During this disconnect, where all users would typically be disconnected from a channel, the first person to recreate that channel could give themselves operator privileges, then remove the previous operators and claim the channel. A similar strategy, called NIC collision, was used to prevent the usage of a particular nickname. The issue came to a head when a server called Eris, named after the Greek goddess of chaos and discord, became the last to allow the sort of unfettered connection that was causing these problems. The solution was found in the form of a queue line, which allowed certain servers to be quarantined from the network that a server chose to connect to. Slowly but surely, the various servers standardized this queue line, and two networks were formed, the EFNet, EF standing for Eris Free, and the remaining AnarchyNet, which fell into disuse. EFNet would continue to suffer from various forms of net splits and channel takeovers. Over the first half of the 1990s, various networks came to prominence to improve the security for channels, servers, and users, such as by implementing timestamps for the creation of channels and nicknames, so that when there were two conflicting usernames or channels after a net split was resolved, the original version could be reinstated. As time went on, the user base for IRC servers fell. However, to this day, hundreds of thousands of users still appear on various IRC servers. Instant text communication was a proper utilization of the network that had started with ARPANET, but from the early experiments of audio communication for voice-based conversation, progress had been made to make this technology into programs that could be used to have electronic conversations.
User joined your channel. User disconnected from your channel.
In 1989, Rascal, or Remote Audio Sound Card Application Link, became the first program where two users could have a conversation by speaking into a microphone, where Rascal would convert that sound into ones and zeros and communicate it back and forth between two computers, becoming the first ever Voice over Internet Protocol program, or VoIP. Rascal was designed with gamers in mind, so that they could communicate with each other in online matches. However, internet speeds at that time weren't up to the task. Rascal was the precursor to modern VoIP software Netphone, first released in 1991. Rascal's major shortcoming was that it was designed for communication on an Ethernet network, rather than connecting computers via the internet. This issue was confronted in 1995 by an Israeli company called Vocaltech, which released the Internet Phone, a VoIP service separate from the Netphone mentioned earlier, and charged users by the minute, like a traditional phone plan. According to a 1997 comparison of various audio types, the proprietary file type that Vocaltech created had a bitrate of 22.4 kilobytes per second, which sounds like this. Skype, the first really big VoIP program, was released in 2003 with the aim of making calls cheaper by using peer-to-peer protocols, as was being used by programs like Napster and LimeWire at the height of early internet piracy. Skype wasn't doing anything illegal, however, leading to it being bought and sold several times before ending up with Microsoft, who owns it today. Skype brought VoIP to a new audience from outside the business and computer enthusiast worlds, and had 300 million monthly active users in 2015. For some, Skype wasn't enough, especially for the gamers who Rascal had tried to serve all those years ago. The three big gaming VoIP services were TeamSpeak, Mumble, and Ventrilo. From their release in the early to mid-2000s to the mid-2010s, these three programs dominated the gaming VoIP market. They helped coordinate efforts of teams of players, such as guilds in World of Warcraft, as well as facilitate communication within communities. This meant that a game server would often also have a VoIP server where players could converse with their teammates and competitors. Improving sound quality made for more reliable communication, and by the early to mid-2010s, digital audio transmission over these programs was brought to a very high standard. Chat features existed for these programs, but they were limited to text and disappeared after the user disconnected from the server. Meanwhile, programs dedicated to text-based conversations were moving in another direction. Security had always been a concern with communication over the internet, and users began to seek programs that were capable of keeping their conversations private from unintended third parties. And so three large encrypted messaging programs came into existence: ICQ in 1996, then Telegram and Signal in 2013 and 2014. These programs have, or are capable of, end-to-end encryption. This has the effect of making communications immune to meaningful interception, as the messages are only able to be understood by the sender and receiver. The way this works is based on the mathematical fact that it is easy to multiply two large prime numbers, but very hard to find these two prime numbers given their product. This feature has had varied benefits and disadvantages. It has allowed for free communication within oppressive regimes and during events like the 2021 coup in Myanmar, but has also allowed terrorists, pedophiles, neo-fascist movements, and organized crime to hide, to an extent, their activities from authorities. These groups do have to keep their guard up though, as the example of the encrypted mobile app Anom, created by the FBI, demonstrates. The app was spread by undercover agents and informants to criminal networks and, in conjunction with the Australian Federal Police, led to more than 800 arrests of criminals globally in 2021, as the culmination of a 3-year-long operation. At this point, I've discussed many different programs with different uses on different platforms. This chaos would lead a game development studio named Hammer and Chisel to develop the next big thing in online communication. In 2015, Hammer and Chisel released Discord to good feedback and a modest user base, which would expand rapidly from 2016 onwards. Discord was originally branded as For Gamers, but grew so large that it dumped the gamery aspects of its design and appealed to a wider audience. Discord, in and of itself, had not created any groundbreaking new technology. Instead, it had brought together all the elements of online communication and simplified the process to create and manage these elements. It took in the channel structure of text chat from IRC, voice communication from VoIPs like Rascal, TeamSpeak, Mumble and Ventrilo, but removed the barrier of needing to know how to create a server by handling all of that on their end, allowing users to create a server with the greatest of ease for free. It did improve on the chat functions of early VoIPs by not requiring users to leave a server to join another one or to quit the program, instead allowing users to stay in servers perpetually and be able to read back over their chat messages from previous sessions. The obfuscation of server details also had added security benefits for Discord, such as not leaking the IP address of server members to the server admin, which was an issue in TeamSpeak and also for Steam's voice chat function. Discord has courted controversy over their moderation policy, sometimes exhibiting double standards as well as demonstrating contentiously censorious tendencies. Discord has also been used by various extremist and criminal elements, which Discord has tried to crack down on with varied success.
I'm trying to have a Teams meeting, you fool. We're trying to have a Teams meeting, you fool.
Zoom was created in 2011 as a video conferencing service with moderate success, continuing to grow steadily through the 2010s before exploding in use at the inception of the COVID-19 pandemic, which made video conferencing a mandatory part of working and living rather than a niche gimmick. Microsoft also got a big boost in users during the pandemic for their equivalent to Zoom, Teams. Universities, schools, offices, and families were all using Zoom to talk to people who they were separated from as a result of lockdowns or illness. Zoom had its security issues laid bare as various Zoom bombings or raids of Zoom calls by outside elements occurred. This led to a gradual adoption of a password for Zoom calls that were for business or education. Teams had the inherent advantage of being associated with a Microsoft account, which generally blocked accounts from outside an organization. Zoom's laying of groundwork for a decade gave them a base from which they could spring and capture market share during the pandemic. Despite having an inferior interface compared with Discord's, fewer features than Discord, a lower bitrate throttle resulting in poorer audio and video quality than Discord, and a more restrictive software as a service model than Discord, which allows unlimited calls for free. Presently, Zoom's user base sits at 300 million active users, Teams at 270 million, and Discord at 150 million.
I'll create a GUI interface using Visual Basic, see if I can track an IP address.
Since the first test of the ARPANET in 1969, technology has moved past crashing after inputting two letters. The early newsgroups and IRCs influence communication structures online to this day, and also the online culture and slang that is used, though the high aims of netiquette were given up as more and more of the unwashed masses appeared online as computers became more affordable, and the internet changed from being an impenetrable meeting place for nerds to being a necessary tool for business and communication. So too did the early voice tests of the 70s carve the path for the early VoIP programs of the 1990s and 2000s, culminating in the combination of features that Discord boasts. From the lawless days of NetSplits and server takeovers, the internet has become a centralized and regulated place. I've put aside discussing them, as social media platforms are a different kind of communication compared to examples that I've discussed today, but mega corporations like Meta, Twitter, Reddit, and Microsoft own great quantities of the internet, and their power in moderation decisions and indecisions has been cause for much discussion. Ultimately, the improvement of online communication has been a great boon for humanity, making rapid communication between people who are geographically divided not only possible, but convenient. Ideas can be shared, deals struck, projects coordinated on, and an infinite number of other possibilities.
I wonder, though, what sort of a life would it be like in social terms? I mean, if our whole life is built around the computer, do we become a computer-dependent society and a computer-independent individuals?
In some ways, but they'll also enrich our society because it'll make it possible for us to live really anywhere we like. Any businessman, any executive could live almost anywhere on earth and still do his business through a device like this. And this is a wonderful thing. It means we wanted to be stuck in cities, we better live out in the country or wherever we please, and still carry on complete interaction with human beings as well as with other computers.